much. Now, this is one of the surprises I have for you folks. We have a special visitor here who we have with us in the last 2 years, just once in a blue moon. I mean, really, maybe once or twice a year. And it just so happens that John, who's 7 years old now, had his treatment at the Phoenix Children's Hospital on Friday. And so we thought it might be okay if he hung out with us for a while and came up here and had a little bit to say to everybody. And thank you for your prayers. And we're just really excited. I mean, having the whole family, this is all of us except for Brooklyn, who's already married. She's got her own family. We gave her away. Yeah, Mike is over there saying she's a Turner now. She does not count. But we rarely have the whole family together in one place for church. And so I'm really excited to present to you 7 years old, Mr. John Boss. How about a good name?
My name is John Boss. I have leukemia. My hair fell out. My eyes were black. My teeth hurt. My joints hurt. My muscles hurt. My friends were in the hospital and some of them died. But there's one thing I've learned, that I'm more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ.
Oh, yes, sir.
My mama, Pamela Boss.
Come on up here and do some push-ups.
Good morning, Buckeye First Assembly of God.
Good morning.
I am so happy and so delighted to be here with you. For those of you who don't know how we're connected, I guess it all started with Joanne Boss, right over there. And she is, of course, the mother-in-law and the matron of all of this. And so we truly are happy to be here. As Jeff was mentioning, it's once in a blue moon. I want to tell you today that I am not here to lift up the name of cancer, or sickness, or death, or anything of the sorts. I only have a few minutes of your time this morning, and John and I have to be on our way. As Papa mentioned, he shouldn't be out in public right now with a very low ANC count, and especially since he just got the treatment, it's going to be at its lowest point. So we don't want to expose them to anything, but I'm so delighted that we have the opportunity. If I had just a few minutes of your time, there is a message I would like for you to walk away with today. And I hope that you're able to get that through these few minutes that I have to share. You've heard it said that often life comes through death. Having leukemia, having a son who has leukemia, to me and to this family was like having that death sentence, if you will. And every day we face the challenges of that death sentence, just as you face your challenges. You know, just as I am, you too are that soldier in the battle. And just as Dale mentioned, it's not about us, but it's about his purposes.
Amen.
It's about his agenda and how he can use you and I to fulfill those things here on this earth. Nevertheless, each day we have to rise up to that. Sometimes you don't feel like rolling out of bed and getting in line to do that very thing. But I want you to walk away with this one thing. I'm going to share with you just some of the things that Jonathan and this family has had to go through, only so that you can then embrace the goodness and the bigness and the miracle and the obvious hand and powerful work of the Holy Spirit through this journey. I want you to know first that there has not been one single time in which Jonathan has taken his blood work or taken his chemo treatments and had the expected outcome. Mrs. Boss, when he's given this treatment, these are the 10 things that are going to happen. Praise the Lord. It has never been as bad as what they say. And that's because, why is that? Soldiers, why is that? Because we serve a living God who cares about you and I. And as we mentioned, this is his battle and not ours. We fight as best we can, but we fight the power of Jesus, don't we? The finished product. Jeff mentioned that it's very difficult to come back to your home church, and it truly is. So many of you out there have participated and taken part in our journey, and I'm here to tell you thank you. I don't know who the little lady is that is so diligent in this church that is continually sending messages through my mother-in-law, but to you and to your heart, I want to say thank you. And to Nana Margie and Linda Puga, who have been so much a part of what we do, she's here today, thank you. You know, oftentimes when we do things, we feel prompted to do things, and we move out and act on that. Sometimes we don't know the full implications of how that affects others. Example of that is Debbie Dunning is here, and she and Lester have been very much part of who we are as well, from Sunday school teachers and all the way up. I understand she knows that my mother-in-law loves these blueberry muffins, and so she's faithful to come across with those famous muffins. And we were at Nana's house, and after chemo treatment, you know, you can be served your favorite dish, and it just doesn't taste right. And so after about the 15th try of trying to get Jonathan satisfied and content, Nana says, well, I have some muffins. Can we try some muffins? Debbie, your muffins saved the day. And Jonathan was able to go to sleep last night. And Jeff and Pamela were able to get a little bit of rest. The point is, thank you for walking out and being obedient and being that soldier. Sometimes, as I said, we don't know the effects of what those things that we do and how they're going to affect others. But my message to you today is this very simple thing. In spite of the battle, you have to know that our Lord hears your prayers, knows the desires of your heart. Not only does he hear, he cares, yes. And he answers prayer.
Amen. Amen.
He hears,
yes.
He cares,
yes.
And he answers prayer.
Amen.
This journey has been the most difficult journey of our life, and it has affected us on every front of our life. Not just John's physical body. I'm talking about relationships between siblings. I'm talking about relationships between husband and wife. I'm talking about finances. I'm talking about the myriad of decisions. As you know, the Boss family is always away, so generally it's just Jonathan and I and perhaps William. And so that makes things even more challenging. In the midst of it, we know that God cares. He hears and he answers prayer.
Thank you, Jesus.
And each day when it's time to begin that day, and it's exhausting and overwhelming, we embrace those truths and we remember his faithfulness through it all. And we look at the miracle over there, because as John enters into the hospital each time, they say, I don't know why it hasn't affected him yet, but I'm sure it'll catch up eventually. We serve a mighty God, and he is bigger than cancer, and it is only through him and through his strength that we're able to get through. And once again, you all figure into that. Christy, Sam, you figure into that. We are the hands, the mouthpiece, and the feet that accomplish that work while we're here. So from the bottom of my heart, I want to say thank you so very much for being a part of our journey. Childhood leukemia is on a rampage. It is rising. Cancer as a whole is rising. There's one thing that's different about pediatric cancer. You as an adult have a choice to sign up, to say, I will treat my cancer this way, that way, or the other way. But with pediatric cancer, you have no choice. No integrative medicines. You have no choice. It will be according to the protocol given to them, or your child will be taken away from you. Mm-hmm. I have to tell you, I live very close to the Mexican border. In spite of the fact that Jonathan is doing the national protocol, Jonathan is thriving, and Jonathan is what they call a member of the 2% club, because seldom does a child come out with the results that Jonathan has come out. His treatment is 3 years and 2 months, of which we have 20 months left. And they say, Mrs. Bosta, at some point he will crash and burn, so be expecting it. I'm telling you again that my God hears and cares and answers prayers. I am not expecting it. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for being a part of our journey, for embracing my family. And although the journey is difficult each day, I want you to know that today I can truly say from the bottom of my heart that it is well with my soul. God bless you.
Ride this train, ride this train.
Straight for me. much. Good to see you here on Sunday morning. And in case we haven't got to meet you yet, you're probably getting the impression that we are one big happy family. Most of the time. They're supposed to smile and do something. And we're really always glad to come back and see my mama here. This is her home church, if y'all didn't know that. So, in a minute, I'm going to tell you a little bit about how this band came to be. The seeds for this started over 60 years ago. That's right. And I'll tell you about that in a second. But right now, how about a big hand for Mr. Micah Boss on the mandolin. So much, everyone. Just very quickly, you'll be here on the fiddle. We have my little sister Faith. Big hand for Faith, yeah.
Right here on the guitar, the left-handed guitar, I have my little sister, our little sister, Liberty, and she's singing lead, and she does an excellent job, so why don't you give her a big hand. Thank you so much. This here's my little sister, Felicity. Felicity's 15, plays the drums, the bass, the guitar, and mandolin. Give her a big hand, my sister. It's great to be here. Over here is my little sister, Charity. She is 13 years old. How about you make her feel welcome? Thanks so much, everybody. This here is my papa. He plays banjo. His name is Jeff Boss. I love him very much, especially on pay. So give him a big hand.
Thank you. That'll come out of your pay. I give her things to say because they're like, we don't know what to say. I'm like, hey, you got
to
say something complimentary and loving and follow the script, for goodness sake. 13 years old, I tell you what. They should take all the teenagers and put them on the Isle of Patmos until they turn 20, right? Wouldn't that solve all the problems in the world, right? Did we get everybody? I'm going to introduce Will here in just a second, folks. But while I have your attention on, everybody look at Will and really make him feel embarrassed over there. And he does such a great job for us, folks. He's going to sing for you in a bit, but good guitar player, good fiddle player, and he's coming up in the family tradition and going to be playing it all for you. They don't know any better, but they just figure everybody does it. Well, we got the best job in the church, I think, and the good Lord lets us travel a lot all over the country. And I never, you never know what you're going to get when you pull out the banjo. You know, if you're up in Seattle or Los Angeles, you pull out the banjo and people's eyes get really big. They're like, what in the world is that? And of course, when we're out in Louisiana or Southeast Texas, you pull out the drums and their eyes get really big and they're like, what in the world is that? But we just enjoy playing for the children of God all over the country. You know what? We're all bound together in our Lord Jesus Christ, and that all of these great people, from around the world have kneeled before the Savior and said, you know what? I need to be saved. I need my sins to be cleansed. And you know what? Regardless of race, religion, creed, or whatever, all over the world, we got points of light all over the country, all over the world, united together in our battle against evil. Let's get Charity up here, and I think we'll do, since we've got the banjo out, we'll do a good old-timey bluegrass tune. How about a little Holy Unto the Lord? It worked when I had it, is all I have to say. There we go. Children, understand. All right, here we go. Thank you. hope we have in Jesus Christ, folks, that when you really sit down and, you know, think about it and ponder about it and think about the fact that, you know, even death itself has been taken captive by the finished work of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, it doesn't leave too many things to worry about at night, does it? This one's about the great hope we have in Jesus Christ, but it's got the wrong name. It's called Happy I'll Be. But I think we want to change this to Happy I Am. Let's do it. Guitar. That's the most important thing. But this guy is a genuine, real-life Arizona cowboy. Where is he? Come on over on this side, buddy. You don't fall off the steps. Real-life, genuine cowboy from southeast Arizona. And this little guy was, I'm just telling the truth here. You know my wife, she was just here a minute ago. This kid was born in a cattle trough in southeast Arizona almost 10 years ago. And here he is, 10 years old, going to sing for us. How about a little, I'm on my way.
Go.
here. We're going to be releasing a new CD on April 1st. And don't worry, we got 500 of them with us today. And we had a concept last summer. We knew we were going to make a new record. And we were going to try to do something really progressive, you know, on the order of, you know, a little bit more praise and worshiping. And in October, November, as I was praying about it, I just really sensed the Spirit of God kind of moving on me, saying, that's a bad idea, Jeff. Here's a good idea, is to play some of the great hymns of the faith that we grew up with. And then so we started hashing it out in November and getting these songs together. And then another one of those great kind of Spirit-inspired moments, I just said, you know what, I need my mama to sing on this. Because some of y'all remember the old Assembly of God Church when it was over there at Buckeye, the old building. And you probably remember me when I was just a little guy. And my mama was leading all the songs in church. And these are the songs we used to sing. And I'd be playing a guitar. It was a little electric guitar, a cake that I'd have at a yard sale in Avondale for $20. And my little Sears amplifier turned up full blast. And you couldn't see it from where you were, but behind her back, my mama was doing this. Which meant turn it down. And who would have ever guessed that 30 years later, they'd be playing that way in church all the time. We're going to do one from the old days. How about sing along? Those CDs are out there on the table, folks, and make sure you grab one on your way out. They're just available for donations. We've been doing this for about 10 years, and I remember 10 or 12 years ago, one of our mentors was counseling and said, oh, no, you can't offer CDs for donations. There's just no way you're going to make it. And, you know, from my perspective, as Pamela and I were praying about it, we just figured, we don't want to be out here on the road for, 250 days, it's 250 nights away from home a year, unless God's really in it. And one of the great uses of money these days, folks, is, of course, to discern God's will. And if you're praying about something right now and you say, oh, Lord, I wonder if it's your will if I should do this, the first thing you should check is your bank account. Because if there's not enough money there, brother and sister, it's not God's will.
Yeah.
If there is enough money there, that's permission to go to step two. You know what I mean? Because God has no shortage of resources. I can remember being up in Northern California, brother and sister, 2008 summer. No, early fall. I mean, when he crashed. And in Yreka, California, Northern California, the price of fuel was $5.08 a gallon for diesel. And our bus takes 140 gallons. And brother, sister, I remember I pulled up into the truck stop there and I saw what the price was and pulled over to the side because I stayed with my wife, Pamela. And I mean, I was quivering saying, we're not going to have enough money to get home. And so we prayed there on the spot. What should we do? And you know what? The Spirit of God just really calmed my heart and says, you know what? Here's a paraphrase of Scripture. I own the oil wells on 1,000 hills. No worries. And brother, sister, in faith, we filled that tank up and we went on into the Northwest and completed our tour. And brother, sister, when we got home several months later, we had money in our pocket to spare. And brother, sister, it's a testimony to the faithfulness of God.
Yes.
Because brother, sister, if he wants you to be there, neither hell nor high water is ever going to stop you from being there. And sometimes we don't want to hear what God has to say. But I do, because I'll tell you what, 250 nights away from home, away from my wife, is getting hard. So I always say to the Lord, are you sure you want us to go to Texas this year? Yes, I do. So we're going to go on. Help yourself back there. Make sure you grab something on your way out today. I wasn't always the good-looking, wonderful guy you see in front of you here. Maybe you all who know us a little bit better, particularly in my 20s, during college and when I was in the Army, where I really went out, folks, kind of like the prodigal son, feeding at the hog trough of the world. And, just a couple of years ago, we were traveling through East Texas, brother and sister, and I was meditating on what the wonderful things God's done for us. If I was God, I probably would have just wrote me off and just given me a kick in the pants and say, hey, man, you got what you deserved. You made your bed. You can just spend the rest of your life in misery. But, God's not that way. When the prodigal son came back, there was his father at the end of the walk waiting for him. And brother, sister, if that's you, I can tell you, your father in heaven is waiting for you to say, you know what, I'm tired of it. I'm ready to come home. And then I was remembering all the wonderful people in my life who helped make that into a reality, like my darling wife, who never gave up on me, and my praying mama, and my praying papa. This song was kind of born out of it. I hope you like it.
Oh,
them each morning. She somehow knew I'd thought about a way back to that blessed hope I started from. Everybody here is probably going through something. I know if we got to know each other, you know, we would trade stories of woe, and it would be hard to find who has the most misery here, folks, because let me tell you what, we live in a world that is infused with sin. It's a fallen world, folks. This isn't the world that Adam and Eve saw when they came. It's a different world than it was then. And we have a lot of sin. I know there's a lot of folks out there who say, you know, if there was a God in heaven, you know, he would do something about it. He's going to do something about it, folks. You know, it's not he would if he could. He can and he will is the answer to that question, folks. But he will do it in his own good time. Because, brother, sister, one of the things he wants to teach humanity is that, brother, sister, there are consequences to sin. And we see those consequences every single day. And then we say, God, why don't you do something about it? And he says, I did. I gave my son, Jesus Christ, so that you could be saved from your sins. Brother, sister, we live in this world because we have a mission from God. And I know, like many of you, sometimes as we go through life, we pray all the time, Father, if you just tell me plain what you want me to do, I would do it. And the Father says, I have told you plainly in my word what I want you to do. Brother, sister, it's the most easy, the hardest part is kind of the easiest part, because he says, I want you to get out of bed in the morning and love the people around you when nobody is watching. You know what I mean? I want you to come to the breakfast table with a smile. I want you to be loving and to forgive. You know what I'm saying? You say, Jesus, if you just tell me what to do, which road should I take? And he says, oh man, you know, a lot of the roads that we take in life are not near as important as the roads we take in our heart. You know what I'm saying? You could be on the quote-unquote right road of life and be totally on the wrong road in your heart. You know what I'm saying, folks? This song kind of speaks to that, because I know many of us have spent a lot of nights like one of the great fathers of the faith, King David, as he lay in his bed and said, you know, I'm soaking my bed with tears. I'm praying and I'm praying, but it just doesn't seem like those prayers are getting through the ceiling. And brother, sister, if you've ever felt that way, this song's for you. It's called The Journey.
I'm
finds an old dry road.
I'll stand.